فاسألوا أهل الذكر إن كنتم لا تعلمون.
إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا، من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له، وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، وأشهد أن محمدًا عبده ورسوله. Dear viewers, brothers and sisters in Islam, Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. I'm your host, Karim AbuZaid. Let's talk about it. This is your show where you call in with your questions. The phone number is 1-800-651-4814. You can call and present your answer to us in person. And inshallah, we will try to be nice and kind to you over the phone, you know, speak to you softly and take your questions. But if you still feel a little bit embarrassed to be on the air, that's fine. You know, it's okay. It's legal to have that feeling. Then you can go ahead and email your question, and the email address is there, karim@guideus.tv. I believe we do have a caller. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
Assalamu alaikum.
Wa alaikum assalam wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Name, state, and question, please.
Assalamu alaikum.
Wa alaikum assalam wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Name, state, and question, please.
My name is Tahsin Abdul Rahman. I am from Michigan.
Yes, Tahsin, and your question tonight.
I had two questions.
Sure.
First question is that I read that wearing plain red is forbidden for men. So I had one red t-shirt. Can I wear that?
It is disliked, to answer you quickly. But you can wear it, but disliked.
Okay.
Okay.
And my second question is about the importance of Khilafah and how can it be re-established, and what is the Islamic ruling on election or vote system?
All right, man, you're going to get us into politics here, that's fine. Brothers and sisters in Islam, when we talk about different type of governments in Islam, well, different type of governing in general, we say that there is an Islamic way of governing, and there is the way that is adopted in Europe here, which is the democratic way of governing, where the people, actually the masses, do choose their leaders through the electoral votes. And we do have the dictatorships. So we end up with three types of governing in Islam. Dictatorship is really one-man show, where the person tells the people, like the Pharaoh told the Egyptians a long time ago, and I think they are keep telling the people that until this very day, مَا أُرِيكُمْ إِلَّا مَا أَرَى وَمَا أَهْدِيكُمْ إِلَّا سَبِيلَ الرَّشَادِ. I only show you what I see. The guys got the vision, and I'm guiding you to the right path. You guys are going to have to force to follow me, whether forcefully or whether unwillingly. So these are the three types of governing. Of course, the one that we have here in the United States is the democratic voting system, where every individual has a vote, and his vote or her vote would count. Now, the Islamic governing system is a little bit different, and this is what we call the Khilafah. The Khilafah. First of all, the way it's done through something called in Islam al-Bay'ah, the pledge, where the person is nominated to begin with by Ahlul Hall wal Aqd, the influential people in the society, in the community. And those are normally the religious scholars, the people actually who have the knowledge. they actually nominate. I'm talking about the establishment of an Islamic governing system, the way that it was established during the time of the Sahaba, the companions of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and radwanullahi alayhim jami'a. So first of all, the person is nominated by the influential kind of, how do you call those, Ahlul Hal wal Aqd, the influential team or group in the society. And those are normally the learned people, the people who have the knowledge. If there is a consensus or at least a majority selecting a certain ruler, then the matter goes to the public, the general public, and they also give the general pledge, which basically they say to that ruler, we will obey you as long as you obey Allah and His Messenger. But the moment that you disobey Allah and His Messenger, sallallahu alaihi wasallam, we're not obliged to obey you. So this is what the Khilafah is all about. Now, are we required to establish that? First of all, I really think that we need to establish it in our homes. You know, we need to start establishing things in our homes to begin with. But yes, we are required to establish the Khilafah if we're able to. Through the normal means and course of action that does not violate the rights of any other group. I hope I answered you. Jazakallahu khairah. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
Wa alaikum salam.
Naam. Name, state, and question.
I'm calling from California. I have a question. I want to know, is it okay if like a child finishes the Quran? And if we could do a little ceremony and get together, like a party with gifts and invite people, is that okay in Islam?
Jazakallah khair for the question. Our sister from California is asking regarding one of the children memorizing the Quran and putting a ceremony together. Here is the practice which is according to the Sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, which for us is Anas ibn Malik taught us that. Anas, whenever any of his family members or himself would finish the recitation of the Quran, they would just, you know, where they are gathering, where they are sitting down, and then they would just make dua. They would just make dua, that's all. But more than that, you know, something that was not established. But if we're talking about the recitation of the Quran, there is no need to do that. But, you know, one of the young Muslims memorizing the Quran, I would encourage you to actually have something of that nature in order to promote that spirit, in order to show appreciation for our young and future generations for memorizing the Quran. But not simply for finishing reading the Quran. I know this has been practiced places. You can gather and make dua. That's something that you can do. But that sort of ceremony where you invite people and you have a party and people provide gifts and all of that should be given to someone who memorizes the Quran, and Allah knows best. Jazakallahu khairan.
Okay.
Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
Wa alaikum assalam wa rahmatullah.
Naam, name, state, and question, please.
Lawrenceville, Georgia.
Okay, you're calling from Georgia, and your name, please?
My name is Abu Niyya.
Okay, Abu Niyya, and your question tonight?
My question is about istinja. If somebody pass gas out, should he make a wudu, or should he can just make with wudu without istinja?
Jazakallahu khaira. The need to do istinja, and for the viewers who do not know the word in Arabic, istinja is removal of impurities from the private areas. This is done after urinating and after defecating, but passing wind, there is no need to do that. Jazakallahu khair. Unless if you feel something came out, you know, and I know this is kind of disgusting, but you know, this is the way it is.
Yes, kind of, that's true.
Yeah.
Just wanted to make sure.
Yeah, but just passing wind, no, there is no need for you to do that.
It's not considered like the sunnah, is it sunnah to just go ahead and do the wudu? That's the thing I wanted to make sure.
What do you mean it's sunnah? What do you mean by that?
It's not going to be considered like a bidah if it's just it's my feeling that should I just go ahead and do the thing before I make
I think I answered you.
Hello?
Yeah, I think I answered. Okay. I answered you. Don't follow the whispers of Shaitan. Shaitan can whisper to you in that area and play his game with you. Okay, stick to the Sunnah. Stick to the Sunnah. Jazakallahu khaira. Barakallahu fi. Good man. Georgia. I just returned from Georgia. I had fun there. It was fun in Georgia. All right, dear viewers, brothers and sisters in Islam, 1-800-651-4814. Please give us a call. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Assalamu alaikum. Naam, name, state, and question, please.
This is Brother Mu'izz Muhammad from New Jersey.
Brother Mu'izz, how you doing?
How are you doing, Imam?
Alhamdulillah, how's it going?
Alhamdulillah, we're looking forward to having you soon.
Inshallah, I'm looking forward to visiting you. I'm coming to your masjid, right? Inshallah.
Yes, inshallah, you're coming.
Inshallah. You got to send me some titles, you know, you tell me what to talk about and I will do it, inshallah.
Oh, yes, inshallah, I will. But for the time being, I have two questions for you, Imam.
Sure, go ahead.
They're different questions. One is regarding the mustache. I know that some people say that shaving the whole mustache is not allowed because Imam Malik, Rahimullah, said that if someone, you should throw a shoe on the person who shaves it. So I just wanted the deal for that. And another one was regarding Bukhari and Muslim. Now, many Muslims I've spoken to say that every single hadith in Imam Bukhari Sahih and Imam Muslim Sahih are 100% Sahih. And what I've heard is that there have been some hadith scholars who have said that not everyone is Sahih. But some Muslims have told me, no, every single one is Sahih, and if someone classifies some as weaker than that, then don't listen to them. So I was hoping if you could clarify that.
Jazakallahu khairan. For those are very good questions. May Allah reward you, brother Mu'izz. The first question regarding the mustache. Here is the hadith. اعفو اللحى وقصو الشارب. وفي لفظ حفو الشارب. قصو means shorten. حفو means remove it. So there is a ground for both in Islam, actually. But the view of Imam Malik, actually, he would recommend the person to be flogged if he actually does remove the mustache completely, like using razor blades. But again, the subject is open for interpretation amongst the jurists. Hifu, i'fu, because of the two words which are used in the same issue. Hifu means remove. Now you can do this with scissors. You remove it completely. Qussu, you shorten. You shorten. So this is the ruling. But at the end of the day, as long as you have a beard and you don't have a mustache, I would look at that to be okay, alhamdulillah. But again, we have to go back to the wording of the hadith and stick to that. What really bothers me when I see brothers having mustache without beards, that is for myself is like a killer out there. It's like we're going against the commands of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. As for the second issue, Mu'izz, here is what we say. Let's not be fanatic about this, and let's not be also loose about it, because if we become loose about it, we're really striking the foundation of this religion. Listen, here is how the scholars address this issue. There is unspoken consensus. Look at this now. A silent, look at the words I'm using. Ijma' samti, a silent consensus that every single hadith in al-Bukhari wa Muslim is authentic. But this does not dismiss the fact that if a scholar of hadith comes and does some work inspecting the authenticity of such accounts, he may come up with flaws. But again, should you do that when there is a silent consensus amongst the scholars of hadith that al-Bukhari or Muslim are authentic books of hadith? Should you do that? When you have wealth of sunnah out there waiting for somebody to authenticate it, al-sunan, the other, you see, sunnah is not only in al-Bukhari or Muslim, there are other books which compile the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And this is the argument which a lot of the scholars took against Shaykhana Sheikh Abu Abd al-Rahman al-Albani rahimahullah. They said, Sheikh, yani instead of going and looking into al-Bukhari or Muslim, and look Sheikh al-Albani rahimahullah immediately. He went, Sheikh Nasser, he went right away and started working in Sunan Abi Dawood, Ibn Majah, and all of these. And so just leave that. Because if you look at the conditions which those two imams put together in order to allow a hadith into their sahih, out of this world, it's almost impossible that you're going to find a weak hadith in that area. And that's why we should leave it at this. Jazakallahu khairan. Enough to say, ya ikhwa, that Imam al-Bukhari compiled his sahih in 16 years. And something amazing, after he even goes through the authenticity and check the narrators and all of this, after he uses the means, he would go and pray istikhara before he allows one hadith in. He would pray istikhara for each single hadith. If you know the amount of time they spent in order to compile those two books, now the ummah accepted them. You know, subhanallah, mm-hmm. and there is that accepted. You see, why Sheikh Nasser, subhanallah, his authentication right now, is a hujjah, is an evidence. But Allah placed the acceptance of his authentication of the hadith in the hearts of the Muslims. This is the work of Allah. Yani, subhanallah, I remember one of these days I was, you know, praying behind somebody in the salah. And he messed up one of the verses in the salah. He messed up one of the verses. And then I corrected him and he refused to take my correction. Fine, you know, I let him go. But after the salah, I told him, brother, يعني, you did this. Bukhari. Look what he's saying. Well, I made a mistake in Sahih al-Bukhari. That's what he's saying. You made a mistake in the Quran. But just to tell you the mentality of the Muslims regarding Sahih al-Bukhari. For them, maghlatnash fil Bukhari. He doesn't, you know, but this is what? This is the way that they, you know, they look at Sahih al-Bukhari. So now you should come now and try to play smart with that. Yani, that's no offense to anybody who tries to do that. We would rather focus and give our attention to other compiled books of hadith and try to authenticate them, because they will confirm at least a lot of sunan, or at least they will sort out a lot of issues which are still subject of debate, like the hadith that we started with, hadith al-sharib. Like the mustache issue. Alhamdulillah, nas'al Allah tawfiq. Jazakallahu khair, barakallahu fi.
Jazakallahu
khair. Salaam wa barakatuh. Okay, I see a lot of people leaving messages on Skype. Please, brothers, do not do so, because I'm not going to check these messages. Please go ahead and call me back, and we'll try to do our best, inshallah, to answer your questions. But I see people leaving messages on Skype. Please go ahead and call me back. 1-800-651-4814 and Karim at guideus.tv. That is the phone, what, the email. And we do actually have a Facebook page, by the way. Let's talk about it. Guideus.tv, let's talk about it. If you go there and post your question, we'll be more than happy also to actually answer these questions for you. Okay, until I hope the phone is still working. Somehow we had a lot of callers and by all of a sudden they disappeared. Where are you callers? Okay, they will call. I know they will, inshallah. Okay, I do have a question here. It's unfortunately about dreams. You know, I don't do dreams. You know, I ask, you ask me, I don't do dreams on that show. So Please do not send me dreams, because I do not, I mean, one-on-one, you know, between you and me, you come to Colorado, pray in Abu Bakr with me this Juma, inshallah, and just tell me about your dream, and maybe I'll give you my input. But I always believe that the person who really can explain the dream best is the dreamer himself, the one who actually dreamt it. I always believe that. I have no idea why. And it's so true, because, you know, Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
Wa alaikum assalam wa rahmatullahi.
Naam, name, state and question, please.
I'm Tahsin again from Michigan.
Okay, brother Tahsin, your question tonight.
My question is that, what is the importance of migration, to migrate from a non-Muslim country to a Muslim country?
All right. You're always coming up with these funny questions tonight. What's going on with you? Are these questions that really bothering you?
No, I just wanted to know.
Okay, our brother Tahsin is asking regarding going from one place to another to save your deen. First of all, I want to say that we do have a lot of text, whether in the Quran, whether in the Sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, that we must make sure that we live in a believing environment, in a Muslim or a faith-based society. Because living amongst, you know, people who do not believe, sooner or later will corrupt the hearts. But now, at this time and age, what is the criteria for that? A lot of Muslims, when this subject is brought up, they tell you, subhanAllah, when we came to America, actually our religion became much better. Well, that's not something that's odd. That's something that is odd. وكما يقول الفقهاء, the scholars, they say, الشاذ لا يقاس عليه. Something that is odd, you don't make a ruling out of it. But we do have hadith, Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, that we shouldn't be living in an environment where there is shirk, there is polytheism, and because this will affect us. Now, there is a verse in Surah Nisa, which the scholars use as the premise to decide whether you should stay where you are or you must leave. What is the verse? Qawlullah ta'ala, I believe it's verse number 96, chapter number 4, Al-Fatiha, Al-Baqarah, Al-Imran, Al-Nisa, yes, 4. Where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, إِنَّ الَّذِينَ تَوَفَّاهُمُ الْمَلَائِكَةُ ظَالِمِي أَنفُسِهِمْ قَالُوا فِيمَ كُنْتُمْ. Indeed, the angels who come and assess the angel of death in seizing and extracting the soul out of the body will question certain people at the time of death, Muslims, yani, but they died as sinners. And that is what is meant by ظالمي أنفسهم. They are in a state of transgression against themselves. And they will ask them this question, فيما كنتم? What caused you to die this way? What? Why did you die as sinners? Look at the way that they answer. قالوا كنا مستضعفين في الأرض. They said we were outnumbered. The reason for that verse, by the way, the Sahaba, the companions, who were commanded to migrate from Mecca to Medina, and they did not do it. And they were forced to go to the Battle of Badr with the disbelievers and fight, and this is what happened when they were dying. They were killed, and this is what happened to them. Just to show you, it's a very similar criteria for what we're talking about. Now, why didn't you migrate? Why didn't you leave? قالوا كنا مستضعفين في الأرض. We were outnumbered. They were outnumbered in Mecca. We could not openly practice our religion. I could not show my Islam. My wife could not wear her hijab because of the way that the society is. Look, will that excuse be accepted? Look, قالوا, they will say, أَلَمْ تَكُنْ أَرْضُ اللَّهِ وَاسِعَةً فَتُهَاجِرُوا فِيهَا. wasn't Allah's earth expansive enough for you so that you can actually leave and go somewhere else where you can practice your religion? الشاهد, or the important thing out of that verse here, is wherever you are you able to practice your deen? Are you able to show your identity as a Muslim? Are you able to pray? Are you protecting your family and yourselves against the trials and tribulations? Answer, if the answer is yes, then stay where you are and carry on establishing the religion. If the answer is no, then you have to go somewhere else, and not necessarily out of America. There are, mashallah, a lot of communities here in America which are established, well established. They do have schools, some of them do have universities. I'm aware of a community in Dar es Salaam in Maryland, Sheikh Safi Khan there, mashallah, they do have a university now, a college, Islamic University. And mashallah, they have schools and they have a community center. You see, what it takes is establishing the religion where you are. If you're able to do this, alhamdulillah, then you stay where you are. But if you're not able to, and your kids are going to public schools and they are faced with that fitna of the culture of public schools, the marijuana business, and all these things, then hijrah is mandatory upon you. I hope I helped you, and Allah knows best. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Assalamu alaikum. And Allah knows best in this subject, because it's a subject of debate amongst the scholars. And this is my little, ijtihad. But I want to say that a lot of scholars of hadith understood this verse the way that I explained it from the early predecessors. I don't recall his name. I think Abu al-Aliya or another one. I just don't recall his name. He said this verse is addressing Muslims who live as a minority in a non-Muslim land until the day of resurrection. He actually said that. And he is one of the tabi'een, one of the second best generation of Muslims. So my understanding of the verse is identical to his understanding because of his statement. Wallahu a'lam. Tayyib. I go back to the dreams. Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam kama inda al-Bukhari, when he, again this is for the sister or the brother who sent that dream thing, just for you to know, I'm going to give you some criteria. I'm not going to explain or interpret your dream because I don't do that. But I will give you some criteria that can help you. Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam kama inda al-Bukhari hadith Abi Hurairah radiallahu anhu, that the dreams which we see in our sleep fall into one of the three famous categories. Number one, from Allah, glad tiding, from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Bushrayat, bushra min Allah. So it's a glad tiding from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Two, from shaitan, frightening dreams from shaitan. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Assalamu alaikum.
Wa alaikum assalam wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
Naam, name, state and question, please.
Yes, brother.
Okay, your question, please.
Okay, brother, I call you back.
Huh?
Okay. I call you back, brother, inshallah.
Okay, no problem. Call me back. You don't
have... Okay, brother. Okay.
Inshallah. All right. What happened here? Assalamu alaikum. Okay. So how far did we go with the dream business now? Three types. We said one of them, glad tiding from Allah, bushra min Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The second one is frightened dreams, ahawil shaitan. Shaitan wanna frighten you in your dream. So he makes you see something which you do not basically like or would scare you. And the third one, hadithun nafs, something that is consuming your, you know, you're thinking about it all the time. Someone is bothering you all the, you know, the whole day long, and you're so angry at that person, you're going to end up seeing that person in your dream because of the way that your nafs is just bringing that person up all the time. Now, how do you draw the line between this and that and that? First of all, how did you sleep? Did you pray five times the day, the previous day? Okay, did you at least remember Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala before you went to sleep? Did you? Did you pray and mashallah you followed the sunnah and so forth? Certainly, if this is what you done, so what you saw is from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala want to give you a glad tiding. Now, what should you do? You can go ahead and share that dream, but with people whom you like, or people who likes good things for you. Don't go to somebody who envies you and hates you and he want to see you collapse and leave this world and tell him, I saw a dream, a beautiful dream that I'm your king, you know. I mean, you're going to increase the hasad, the envy in his heart. And this is what Ya'qub alayhi salam said to Yusuf when he saw that beautiful dream. The 11 stars and the sun and the moon are prostrating to me. He immediately said, Ya Bunay, la taqsus ru'yaka ala ikhwatik, fayakidu laka kayda. My son, do not share that dream with your brothers because they don't like you to begin with. You can talk about that good dream. Actually, it's recommended that you talk about that good dream with someone whom you feel like he likes good things for you. But not someone who may envy you. Now, what about the second type? The second type, which is from shaitan, don't speak about it. Don't actually share it with anybody. Actually, a lot of the scholars, they say when if you speak of it, that means it will be and it will unfold. It will become true. But what you need to do if you woke up during your sleep and you experience that nightmare, basically, it's a nightmare, you just turn to the other side and say, أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم, and move on, فإنه لا يضره, it will not harm you. For hadith al-nafs, I mean, stop thinking about that stuff, you know, unless if it's something good, you know, if you're thinking about, you know, making salah or something, then you're going to see salah and that is the beautiful thing about it. So try to have hadith and nafs, good things, yani inshallah. Okay, we do have another question here. I hope our Skype is working. Assalamu alaikum. Is this hadith is sahih? If yes, who narrated it, and can it explain the meaning of the hadith and the condition Muslims can apply it? Consult your heart, even if you are given fatwa by those who deliver righteous religious verdict. Oh, I see. The hadith is sahih, certainly. So the Skype is working. I believe we're receiving some phone calls here. And let me see here. Oh, hang up again. But it's good. I think that the Skype is working, alhamdulillah. So let's see here. Istafti qalbak. I'm trying to recall the hadith. Aslu fi Muslim. Asluhu, the origin of that hadith in Sahih Imam Muslim. I will come back to it. Let me just see. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
Assalamu alaikum.
Wa alaikum assalam wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
Okay, I have two questions.
Yeah, you want to share name and state first, please?
Sure. This is Amina from New York.
Okay, go ahead, Sister Amina.
Okay, my first question is what verses or what ayah should be read for Rukia, for protection from the evil?
Okay.
And my second question is, I saw somewhere on Facebook somebody sharing that Salah should not be prayed in the dark. Is this true or is it valid?
Okay, Jazakallahu khairan. Okay, our sister Amina from New York, Jazahallahu Khaira, she's a regular caller to our show, mashallah. She's asking the verses of the Ruqya. First of all, the ruqya is not going to work with someone who is not obedient. I just want to establish that. So first, actually, you must, I mean, you know, a lot of the brothers, they come to me and they want to do ruqya. First of all, I tell them, please go and do ruqya on yourself. Why? Why? Because subhanAllah, when you request ruqya from somebody, you disqualify yourself automatically from a rank that you must strive and hope that you will be amongst them. What rank? The rank of al-mutawakkilin, those who possess true reliance upon Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. What I'm trying to say here, I know a lot of you are confused already. Hang in there. Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, في حديث أنس بن مالك رضي الله عنه لو أوله عرضت علي الأمم I was able to see the nations in their way to Jannah in the day of gathering, at the end of the day of resurrection. We know this is a future scene which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made it available to the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam the night of al-Mi'raj, the night of the Ascension. The hadith is long, mashallah, but at the end, the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said that there are 70,000 of my ummah who will enter Jannah without reckoning and without punishment. Without reckoning. Underline this. Reckoning. No hisab. You're not going to stand in the land of gathering and go through all this anxiety and fear. Brothers and sisters in Islam, you probably, some of you experienced the waiting for a cup when you violated the traffic lights and or when you hit somebody, all these lights coming around you and you're waiting for the interrogation. Or probably you've been visited by some uninvited guests, you know. And you know how does it feel, you know, being questioned and asked questions and cross-examined and all of this. I mean, I really would like to get your attention that you need to appreciate the fact that you can go to Jannah without reckoning. Imagine standing in the land of gathering and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will ask you and remind you of every single sin that you've done. Yeah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala may forgive you at the end. We know that. Hatta al-mu'min. Hadith ibn Umar, Hadith al-Najwa, the famous hadith, Hadith al-Najwa, fil sahihayn, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will bring the believer closer to him and he will veil him from the rest of the people in the land of gathering. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will ask al-mu'min, will ask the believer, underline the word believer, which is a higher rank than a Muslim. You remember on that day, you committed that sin? Yeah, I remember. You remember that day I committed? Yes. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is going to remind that believer with all his sins. Huh? Imagine this. To the extent that he will believe, then he's going to perish. That he's going to be thrown in hell. This is the believer. But then the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Allah will say to the believer, I veiled you in the dunya. I veiled you in this world. And in the hereafter, I veiled you in the world. I didn't disgrace you. Even so, you committed that sin, but I didn't disgrace you. The people did not know about it. And you know what? Today I'll forgive you. I mean, this is the ideal that you can expect if you go through reckoning. So, I'm throwing this at you just to appreciate that you're going to get a pass from reckoning, that you're going to go to Jannah straight. Now, when the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said that, of course there is another hadith that adds another 70 with each one of those. So, you know, there is more numbers. So a lot of Muslims actually may go and may qualify to enter Jannah if you group all these, compile all these hadith on that subject together. But here's the piece that I'm looking for. The companions, the Sahaba, what occupied their thinking and their mind when the Prophet ﷺ made that statement, who are those people? And they started suggesting. Then he came back, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and he asked them, what are you discussing? They said, O Messenger of Allah, we're discussing who would go to Jannah without reckoning, without punishment. He said, هم الذين لا يسترقون ولا يكتوون ولا يتطيرون صلى الله عليه وسلم ولا يكتوون وعلى ربهم يتوكلون. لا يسترقون. That's موضع الشاهد. This is الشاهد. You know, I'm narrating the whole thing for that statement. They do not request the ruqya from somebody. That's the explanation of that. But listen, if somebody voluntarily comes and does ruqya on you, that's fine. Jibreel alayhi salam did a ruqya on the Messenger of Allah, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. But the Prophet did not request it. So if you're sitting out there and I put, you know, I come and I say, let me just recite this, do ruqya on you. That's fine. This does not qualify, does not disqualify you from that rank. But you requesting it from others, it normally تَقْذِفْ فِي تَوَكُّلِكَ. Because you normally look at this person, oh, Sheikh Karim, ba, Sheikh Karim, the Sheikh, Imam Karim, يا أخي الله, توكل على الله, Imam Karim, Imam Karim, may Allah save Imam Karim, and save all these Imams. والله نسأل الله سبحانه وتعالى أن يسترنا في الدنيا والآخرة. We ask Allah سبحانه وتعالى to veil us in this dunya and in the hereafter. That's what we're asking. فهذا يقدح في توكلك. First of all, you should not seek it. You should do it in your own selves. But if somebody voluntarily offers you a ruqya, go ahead. Now I'll ask the question. Oh, the verses. First of all, I think the point that got me there is I tell that person, if he insists, now after advising that person not to request the ruqya from somebody because this would disqualify you from falling into the rank of those who possess reliance, tawakkul, true reliance upon Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, which can qualify you to enter Jannah without reckoning and without punishment. What if they insist? I ask the brother or the sister. Normally I don't do the sisters, but the brothers. Do you pray 5 times? The answer is no. It's not going to work. Give me a break, man. What I am, magic? You're going to do spells on you? If you don't pray 5 times, it's not going to work. وَلَعَيَادُ بِاللَّهِ لا. You have to pray 5 times. What wrong are you doing? Are you smoking weed? Even if it is medical, it's not going to work. You know, lately in Colorado here, they came up with these, you know, they made marijuana here entertaining marijuana. That state is going out of bounds, man. I'm telling you, we're having some issues here. But lately, I've been noticing the people, non-Muslims, I just want to let you know that the more they do this, the more clients we get into the masajid. So the other night, I think somebody came into my office, well, in the masjid, after the salah, a non-Muslim. And after we finished the prayer, and he called, somebody introduced him to me, this is the imam. Yes, what I can do for you, what can I do for you? Right away, I can smell marijuana coming out of his breath. I mean, that's what the people told me marijuana looks, smells like. I don't know how that smell, but this is what the people told me how it smells, you know. Some of you are saying, how did you know, Sheikh, that the marijuana smells like that? But I can tell, but the thing is the person is telling me, I'm a non-Muslim, and I think there are a lot of spirits who are speaking to me. A lot of spirits speaking to you. It's because of what you're doing. Spirit speaking to you. A lot of people are talking to me. You need to stop that to begin with. And you need, are you alcohol? I mean, that's not going to work. Yani, a brother the other day calls me, talk to me about the ruqya. Then by accident, I told him, okay, brother, inshallah, what about after Jum'ah? You know what he said to me? I'm sorry, I'm unable to come for Jum'ah. Give me a break, man. You're able to come for Jum'ah? MashaAllah, MashaAllah. You're unable to come to Jum'ah and you want the ruqya to work? Allahu Akbar. No, I asked him, why? Are you sick? No. I think I have something to do. Ya akhi, I told him, ya akhi, you're looking for cure. Ma yinfa hada. The second thing you yourself have to eat, I'm not saying that you have to be perfect. There is no such a thing. There is no such a perfect person. But at least you must be a, striving and fulfilling at least the mandatory and striving to stay away from trouble. But if they fall into that category and if they insist, then I recite the verses of Ruqya on them. And this is the question which we received. Number one, Al-Fatiha. Start with Al-Fatiha. Hadith Abi Sa'id Al-Khudri in Al-Bukhari, the famous story. Number two, the beginning of Surah Al-Baqarah. Alif Lam Mim, the first five verses. Then Ayat Al-Sihr. يعني رسالة آية السحر واتبعوا ما تتلو الشياطين على ملك سليمان وما كفر سليمان ولكن الشياطين كفروا. دين آية الكرسي الله لا إله إلا هو الحي القيوم. Then the last two verses from سورة البقرة. And then the three قل. And then other verses إن شاء الله would also know. السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. السلام عليكم. السلام عليكم. كولر ار يو دي؟ السلام عليكم ورحمة الله.
عليكم السلام ورحمة الله، كيفك يا شيخ كريم؟
أهلا وسهلا، أهلا وسهلا، مين معانا؟
أبو ممتاز باتروج لوزيانا.
أهلا أخ أبو ممتاز، حياك الله وبياك. باتن روج.
الله يبارك فيك.
باتن.
يقول بعد أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم، بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. وطعام أهل الكتاب حل لكم.
الله أكبر.
ما حكم جزاك الله خير، ما حكم اللحمة اللي بتشتريها من كامز وول مارت من المحلات الأخرى؟
أحسن الله إليك.
الله خير.
أحسن الله إليك يا أبو ممتاز، بارك الله فيك. باتن روج لوزيانا is asking about the halal meat. I'm going to have to answer in question in English, inshallah. But let me quickly finish up with the second question of our sister. Okay. Praying in dark, she said some people are circulating some text regarding the impermissibility. Is that a good word? Man, mashallah. Not to pray in the dark, I don't know about it. You can pray in the dark. You're not supposed to close your eyes. Maybe that's what they mean, you know. So if you're in the dark, just, look down. Okay, very quickly, Brother Muaz, and then I will go to that lengthy question. يا أخي, the hadith is authentic. الإثم, here it is. البر حسن الخلق. So the origin of the hadith in Sahih Imam Muslim, where the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, hadith Abi Hurairah رضي الله عنه, the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم says, البر حسن الخلق. بر is to maintain and have a good character. والإثم ما حاك في الصدر وخشيت أن يطلع عليه الناس. And a sin is something that aches inside your chest and you're always concerned that people would see you doing it. وإن أفتوك, even if the people give you fatwa, even if the people give you fatwa, even if the people give you fatwa. But now we must make sure that the صدر, you know, the chest where the aching happens, still sound. Because a lot of people, their hearts turned into what? Into nafs ammara bisu. That the person became so corrupt that he finds enjoyment and he doesn't see his evil no more. So the scholars placed some restriction in understanding this, because if we're going to leave then the assessment or the judgment of what is good and what is bad on what you feel inside your chest, what if that Satan, listen, what Satan is doing is correct? Huh? I'm asking you, whatever Satan is doing, misguiding the human and misguiding his own race and taking them to hell, is it good? It is not good. But you know what? Satan corrupted his nafs that he sees it good. Actually, he has vowed to give his life, his past, present, and future for the mission. Someone who drinks, ya akhi, something that's so amazing, smoking cigarettes. I'm not talking about whether it's halal or haram. We know it's haram, but I'm not talking about that. But imagine this: you go and buy a cigarette, you go and buy a pack of cigarette. And the person who is manufacturing or making that cigarette for you, telling you this is going to kill you. Imagine this. But you're still doing it. Why? Because your heart sometimes may suck your wickedness. And this is what Allah used with Bani Israel. وَأُشْرِبُوا فِي قُلُوبِهِمُ الْعِجْلَ بِكُفْرِهِمْ They loved the worship of the calf. Why? It was fun. You know, the other worship is a lot of work, but the worship of the calf, they get drunk, naked, and they go around it, and they dance, and they have this fine, you know, rituals, you know, activities. They're like, you go to now, and people have pianos, or Muslims dancing around and saying, we're worshiping, we're doing dhikr, that type of thing. Why? Because you end up developing a belief that whatever you're doing is correct. I think I have enough time. 7 minutes left, 6 minutes left to answer Abu Mumtaz. Ya Abu Mumtaz, Barakallah fiqh wa ahsan Allahu ilayk. Nasa Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala an yuthabbitak ala al-haq. And I hope that you have somebody to translate or you understand. I'm sure you understand my English. Wa ta'amu alladhina utul kitaba hillul lakum. And the food of the people of the book is lawful for you. I know that, you know, I answered that question over and over and over and over again, but I'm willing to answer it. We're talking about someone who invites you, Kitabi, a Christian or a Jew, who invites you to his house. Then you could say Bismillah and eat his meat. Of course, they are not supposed to eat pork, so we're not talking about pork here. Christian and Jews, it is not lawful for them to eat pork to begin with. And this is how we understand that Prophet Isa alayhi salam, when he descends, again he will kill the swine. In reference to that. But the people of the book are not McDonald's, are not Kentucky Fried Chicken. Those are businesses. Those are businesses. Now, bifadlillahi ta'ala, by the grace of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, we have all type of dhabiha meat available in our marketplaces, halal stores. Mashallah, may Allah reward all these brothers. And sisters, we have sisters actually who are in the business, who managed to make halal meat available. I'm sure, Abu Mumtaz, in your town there is a halal store. I hope there is one. If not, then you should start one, inshallah. But I'm sure there is one. Why would you leave the Muslim business, someone who invested in making lawful things lawful for you, lawful things available for you? Why would you leave that person and go and benefit all these other giants and super freshes and giants, all of the above? Why would you do this? Just benefit the Muslim businesses is far better, bi-idhnillahi ta'ala. Add to this, yani ya ikhwa. You know, I understand, wallahi, that there are a lot of scholars or students of knowledge like myself who would not give you that answer. They would say, yes, just say Bismillah and eat. Wallahi, a lot of them, they will say that. Ya akhi, the brother who called earlier, brother Tahseen from Michigan, and he asked that question about Hijrah. Remember how we answered them? We have to establish the religion where we are. If we're going to compromise the meat, then compromise the mortgage, then compromise this, then compromise that, then compromise that. Where Islam? Where Islam? The problem with these scholars, they come from overseas and they don't realize the mechanics of I'm telling you something that has to be mentioned. And again, all the brothers and the sisters who come from the subcontinent, I believe, of India, Pakistan, Afghanistan, is that the right word? Subhanallah, the followers of al-madhab, al-imam Abi Hanifa, they have a firm belief regarding this subject, that they must eat the biha. I always like to joke about it, but in no way I'm ridiculing them, that you may sometimes ask one of these brothers, do you smoke? He will say yes. Do you drink? Yeah, sometimes. Do you eat meat that is not dhabih? Astaghfirullah. Astaghfirullah. He will say, Astaghfirullah. No way I will do it. No way I will do it. In no way I'm ridiculing you. I'm actually praising you in that area. Now, you know, you this is the reason why we have all these halal stores. I have 2 minutes. I have a caller. Let me see. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah. Assalamu alaikum.
Hello?
Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah. Can you turn down the television, please?
Okay.
Okay,
I did.
I have 1 minute, please. Yes. Go ahead.
1 minute, okay, brother. As-salah is not accepted in English. How about khutbah al-jum'ah? Sometimes all of it English. And if the khutbah is not accepted, I'm not sure. If the khutbah in English is not accepted, I'm not sure if salah accepted or not. Jazakumullah khair. Assalamu alaikum.
Very quick answer to Abu Mumtaz. Jazakallahu khaira. You know, the view that the khutbah in English is not accepted is not even established. وَمَا أَرْسَلْنَا مِنْ رَسُولٍ إِلَّا بِلِسَانِ قَوْمِهِ لِيُبَيِّنَ لَهُمْ. We sent messengers before you, O Muhammad, using the language of the people to explain to them. The khutbah, for it to be valid, there are, you know, shahada wa salah ala nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, praising Allah, and then the testimony of faith. And then you say sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, you praise the messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. You can come down, by the way. هذه الخطبة. You could say, inna alhamdulillah, ashadu an la ilaha illallah, Allahumma salli ala sidna ma. Sit down, stand up, do another one like this, and then you can come down. So as long as you do this within the context of the English, it is valid. Jazakallahu khaira. MashaAllah, we're done for tonight. That was interesting. Okay, I love you all for the sake of Allah. Don't forget to support Guideus TV. And I look forward again to having you on Thursday, inshallah. The same time, 10 o'clock Eastern Standard, 9 o'clock Central, 8 o'clock Denver Mountain. We're living in the wilderness here. And of course, 7 o'clock Pacific. Assalamu alaikum. ورحمة الله وبركاته
فاسألوا أهل الذكر إن كنتم لا تعلمون.